This is the Strat-O-Matic Baseball Excel 1970-73 Carryover League. Brought to you by the Shrimp Trawler YouTube channel.
Welcome back, baseball fans, to the 70-73 Carryover League. We got a series tonight from the American League North between teams that finished in third and fourth in our division a year ago, the Ohio Players and the Cleveland Indians. Cleveland, of course, worst record in the league last year, had the first overall pick in the draft and went out and made a big trade for Frank Robinson in the offseason. And they were doing great. They were ascending into playoff positioning and a chance of winning the division. So, what happens when you play a expansion team that is truly fictional? Did even play in Major League Baseball during the period? Well, let's take a look at see what happened in Game 1. In Ohio, it was Dick Tidger on the Indians. Ohio Players sent Don Wilson out there. Don Wilson responds with a 3-1 victory. Solo homer by Lowenstein's the only run for the Indians. Ohio Players cobble together some nice middle inning work off of Dick Tidger, get that 3-1 win. They're up 1-0 in the series. Game 2, right back here in Dayton, where the Ohio Players gave a concert before the game, the band that is. And Gaylord Perry for the Indians versus Al Dowling. And the story today is Elrod Hendricks is having nothing of Gaylord Perry. With two on and one out in the bottom of the second, the eighth batter in the lineup, Elrod Hendricks, unloads for a 3-run bomb. Then in the fourth inning, Elrod, another Elrod Hendricks home run. In the sixth inning, Ike Brown adds one off of Gaylord Perry, who, if you've been following very closely over the last several years, I have not had very much luck with Gaylord Perry. Doesn't matter if he's won 24 games, if his ERA is 192, if he's playing for the Giants, if he's playing for the Indians, if he's throwing a spitball, if he's throwing a cotton ball, it doesn't matter. He gets lit up all the freaking time for the last 3 years, every time I use Gaylord Perry. Not a good plan for the Indians, if that is their plan. And they lose this game 5-3. Does it get worse or does it get better when we go back to the mistake by the lake in Cleveland for Game 3? And the answer is, it gets worse. Because Doc Ellis and the Ohio Players are in command throughout this one. Win 7-4, 17 hits for the Ohio Players in this game. Three straight wins over the Cleveland in-state rival. There's your rivalry, folks. In-state rivals, the Ohio Players and Cleveland Indians. And then look at the standings now in this division. This is really kind of shocking here. So the Indians, they were at a wild card, and they still are at 12-10. They were 12-7. They're 12-7 in a very weak American League, and all they had to do was win 2-3 or 3-0, or no, just the opposite. They go 0-3. And now the Ohio Players have a chance to, if they get the sweep today, they're in second place in the weak American League. And now you got teams like the Ohio Players and the Chicago White Sox trying to get into the playoffs in the American League. Well, in the National League, the gaudy National League, you got Mets, Braves, Reds, Pirates, you know, Dodgers, Giants, you know, and all those teams aren't going to make the playoffs. So, just a reminder, the National League is 11 games better in interleague play as well this year. Well, it's a little bit more, too much of a pregame, but you get the idea, folks. We are in Cleveland for Game 4. Must win! Must win TV for the Indians. But today's pitchers, again, favor the Ohio Players. Rudy May, his 1972 card with the Angels, 294 ERA. Ohio's got a really nice starting rotation and some nice hitters in this team. Their bullpen and their defense is not much. Cleveland will send number four starter Steve Hargan, who had a nice 1970. He was 11-3 with a 2.90 ERA for the Indians. Pretty good pitcher, Steve Hargan, in his own right. Let's get started from Municipal Stadium. The drummer is out there in center field doing the, you know what. And here we go. Dave Cash leads off. 37, skies the center. Sonny Jackson, 46, triple one, fly ball on a 4-6. And that is a fly ball on a 2. Steve Hargan. That's usually reserved for the Seavers and Suttons of the world. But my goodness, he gets a triple one fly ball on his card. That's some heady competition there. Chuck Hinton, 55, bounces a short. This is Eddie Leon, a 3 at short, and he makes the play. All right, the Indians have got to get it going today, and leading off for them will be Vada Pinson, 38, rolls the first. Larry Brown, 310, short. And Tony Horton, here's a who. Top of two, Ike Brown, 510, the whiff. Dan Driesen pops to first, and Bill Robinson. Let's take a look at his card. Bill Robinson, 1973 card with Philadelphia, 25 home runs. He did most of his damage after age 30. He was a late bloomer, and he has this nice year. He also had some nice years with the Pirates near the end of the decade. Got a ring with them in 79. 2-5 is homer, 1-8, double. There's your one. There's your problem. He gets the one. That is gone, and just like that, we can say the Ohio players are 24 outs away from a four-game sweep in second place. Yep. Yeah, I can say that. Johnny Jeter, 59, rolls a second. Frank Robinson, the big target in the offseason, but it hasn't really worked out yet for the Indians. 2-8's a single, though. Ray Fosse, 1-6, is a 6. 2-4, 2-3, double play. Danny Walton, 1-5. Let's take a look at Danny Walton's card. He was a Milwaukee Brewer in 1970 with this card. Nice card there. And 1-5 is gone. Buddy Bell, 1-7, double 1-10, the double. Chambliss, 4-10, double 1-15 off Rudy May is a double, and the Tribe takes the lead. Eddie Leon, 65, skies the center. 2-1 in the third, Elrod Hendricks. The boos come out after how he just wrecked the Indians' season in Game 3. 6-10 off Hargan, skies in the center, but you got Pinson out there, a 3 in center. He makes the catch. Darrell Thomas, 54, skies the center. And Dave Cash, 1-5 for Dave Cash. Homer, 1-8, double. It is gone, Dave Cash, and we are tied at 2. Sonny Jackson, 1-7, pops first. Bottom of the third, Vada Pinson, 69. A base hit off Rudy May, C. Steeler. Larry Brown's going to hit and run here. And the runner, 7, has to steal. What do you got catching? You got Elrod with a 0 arm. Pinson is a C. Steeler, not being hold, makes it an 11. 1-11, and he rolls a 12. And he is caught stealing. So Larry Brown will now swing away. 36, would have been a double play ball. Saved us all some rigmarole there. Tony Horton, 62, skies the center field. 2-2 into the fourth. It's Chuck Hinton Witten, 58, skies the right. Ike Brown, 1-6, grounds are short. Dan Driesen, 2-12, rolls the third. Bottom of four, Frank Robinson. 1-2 is a walk. Ray Fosse. Let's take a look at Ray Fosse's card while we're here. 1970 Ray Fosse card. Magnificent. 307. 18 homers. A one catcher with a minus two arm. And oh boy, how great he was before he had that famous collision with Pete Rose in the All-Star game. He was a fantastic catcher all around. And good for Fosse. He did get himself some World Series rings, at least one of them, with Oakland, so it's not really a bad story after he got hurt. Fosse, 6'10", catcher's card. Elrod's a 4'82". That's a wild pitch. We got a runner at second for Danny Walton, 48, and he's 2 for 2 with a base hit in the center field. Frank Robinson's got some wheels, 13. Center fielder Sonny Jackson with a +2 arm, so he's going to run, try and run for the lead, and he does. He scores on a 2. Indians retake the lead, 3-2. Buddy Bell, short B, and with 2 outs, Chris Chambliss, a K. We go to the 5th. It's Bill Robinson, 52, pops the 2nd. Johnny Jeter, 2-4, center. And Elrod Hendricks, 59, there's a walk. Daryl Thomas, 4-4 off the Harrigan card. That would be gone if, oh, holy smokes, folks. Let's take a look at the Daryl Thomas card. I didn't realize it. They gave the dude power. Oh, my goodness. Daryl Thomas, 1972 card with the Padres, 500 at-bats, 5 home runs, and a .230 batting average. And lo and behold, they gave him power. I'm sure Steve Hargan would have preferred increasing the homer chances on Daryl Thomas's card and not giving him power, because now the Ohio Players have taken a 4-3 lead in the 5th. Dave Cash, 5-12, rolls to 2nd. This is Brown at 2nd base as a 3. What is Larry's E rating? Larry Brown is an E-17. Inning is over. Bottom of the 5th. Let's pause a moment for station identification.
This is the Shrimp Trawler video channel.
Este es el canal de videos de camaroneros.
All right. Indians. They're in trouble. They gotta get this thing. They gotta get this comeback win. Very vital here. Eddie Leon, 2-6. Short. The problem when you go down 0-4 in a series, you don't get that cushion to make up those games. It's a -4. It's like a triple bogey or something. I mean, it's like your round is shot. I mean, you can't finish under par with a triple bogey pretty much. And yeah, well, if the Indians go -4 against the Ohio Players, how do you expect to get a +4 against the Tigers and Orioles and Twins and Oakland A's? That's the beauty here in the Carryover League, as we play best of everything's from the start to the finish. There's no playing out the string in our league. Veda Pinson, 66, K's. Larry Brown, 36, rolls to short. You can see the Indians tightening up here. They started well, and now they are behind the eight ball again. Sonny Jackson walks off of Hargan. Hargan's a starter 8, which might be a bad thing because they're tempted to leave him in for a while. The Indians have a good bullpen. Mingori, Romo, Hilgendorf, and Lamb. Very good. So they're not going to let this thing get out of hand. It's very important to them. Chuck Hinton, 2-4. Center. Ike Brown, 38 walk. 2 on for Dreesen. 39 pops a short. And with 2 outs, he homered earlier. Bill Robinson definitely has more homers against lefties, though. 3-11, skies to right field. It's 4-3, bottom of the 6th. Tony Horton, here's a who, leads off. 5-11, skies to right field. This is Bill Robinson, a 2-11 in right field, trying to get an error. They get the double. Indians have a runner in scoring position for Frank Robinson, who's been on twice today. 54, second X. This is Cash, a 3-23 at second base. A single dot, and the Indians got it going. Runners in the corners, no one out. Rudy May, a starter 7. And it's Ray Fosse. Pitch to Ray, 34. Short B will tie the game on a fielder's choice. 4-4. Runner at first, 1 out. Danny Walton, he also homered earlier. 63, first C. Runner second, 2 outs, Buddy Bell. 49 off of Rudy May's card. Double 1-15 is an RBI single, and the Tribe retakes the lead in a back-and-forth affair. 5-4. Chambliss. 2-6, single to center. And I think we're running out the string here in Rudy May. I know he's a starter 7, but he's put a lot of guys on. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Leon will be his last batter. 2 on, 2 outs. 58, skies to left. So he'll leave after 6. Has a chance to get a no decision or a win if his teammates can give him a run or two in the top of the inning. Hargan in the seventh. You're in this precarious position. Really, every guy who has gotten on base has scored for the first five frames. You have solo homers, a walk and a homer, and a couple more walks. You have four runs on three hits. But you still want to be careful with Hargan here. You don't want him to lose after you pull victory out of the jaws of defeat. Johnny Jeter leads off in the seventh. 45, there it is. Triple, 1-6, single. It's a base hit. And you got to really think of, you know, getting the kid out of there. So that's it. Hargan leaves after six. They have better pitchers in the bullpen. They need to use them and get a win. Just win one of these games. They might not be able to come back 0-3, but you got to get a win. And you need your best out there to do it. So Hilgendorf will come on in. Take a look at Tom Hilgendorf. Elrod Hendricks will leave the game. Chuck Hinton will assume catching duties, which opens up the DH spot, which opens up any spot. So let's go with Gene Kleins, ladies and gentlemen. Let's take a look at Gene Kleins' card. This is what I'm talking about, folks. Ohio players. I mean, they got some hitters and some pitchers on the squad. Gene Kleins, 334 hitter. On an absolutely loaded Pittsburgh Pirate team of 1972. Had the best record in baseball, did Pittsburgh, a year after they won the World Series in 71. Only to not even make it back to the World Series in 72. So, Gene Kleins with a runner at first. Here's the pitch. 69, sky's the center. Darryl Thomas homered earlier. Look at Robert O'Pan. We'll leave him in there. 2-7 is a base hit in the center field. Jeter, does he go coast to coast? A 16 runner. Pinson's got a minus one arm, one of 15. They can do it. Coast to coast, they're going to try it. He gets there on 11. So you got runners on the corners. The infield's going to come up. And the batter will be Dave Cash. 3-6 is a K. And with two outs, it's Sonny Jackson. He will come out. That will put what's-his-doodle in center field. Jeter moves over into center. Bill Robinson moves over. He can stay in a right. Ike Brown can go into left field, and Jim Hart will go over in third base where Ike Brown was. And here's Jim Hart batting for Sonny Jackson. Hart, take a look at Jim Hart's card. Nice player with the 1970 San Francisco Giants at 282. But because he gets righties better than lefties, Hilgendorf's going to pitch to him. The pitch to Jim Hart. 410 is third X. This is Buddy Bell, a 313. And he makes the play. And they strand the runners. Big inning there for the Tribe. So they had runners on the corners. You get a strikeout and a ground ball, and they hold the lead 5-4. Bottom of the seventh inning. Stretch time here in Cleveland. We are listening to the James Gang's 1971 LP, Thirds. Seems to me you just walk away. Midnight Man, really great hits on this record. Thirds by the James Gang. All right, back to the game here. Rui May leaves after six. They're going to bring Sal Campisi on in the seventh. And it'll be Pinson leading off. 56 is a walk. Larry Brown, 2-5. Lines are short. Tony Horton, here's a who. 56 is a walk. Frank Robinson, 49. Single, 1-10. Rolls a 12. And with two outs, it's Ray Fosse. 43, right X. Bill Robinson still at right field at 2-11. And he makes the catch. It's a tight game here in Ohio, regardless of which team is home. Into the eighth inning. Righty, righty, lefty. Boy. I think they're going to switch it over here to Romo. Vicente Romo in the eighth will come in. Face the two righties who are very good. No more lefties available on the bench. Hinton, Brown, and then Dreesen. Here's Chuck Hinton. 38 for Chuck is a K. Would have been a walk against a lefty. Smart move there for the Indians. Ike Brown, 59. Rolls a second. And with two outs, it's Dan Dreesen. Now you could bring in Mr. Mingori and try for a four out save here. And I think they're going to do it. They actually are going to do that. Steve Mingori, one of the better closers in baseball. A 1.42 ERA and 71 for the Indians. Fantastic closer. He's had his struggles, but he's been on a roll lately. So, hoping for the best here in the eighth. Trying to get four outs and nail this thing down. Dan Dreesen against Steve Mingori. Here's the pitch. 1-9 is a roller to short. We go to the bottom of the eighth inning. Danny Walton, 39K. Buddy Bell, 55, is a walk. Chris Chambliss, 2-6 is a base hit in a right field. Bell is a 14 runner against the zero arm. Does he try going coast to coast? No, he will not. First and second, one out for Eddie Leone. 5-10 is catcher's card. He would be a 4-16 catcher. Chuck Hinton trying to get an error. And they get the error. Let me just double check that. Yes, he's an E16. That is an error on a catcher. Very rare. And we've got the bases loaded with one out. And it's Pinson. They're going to bring the infield up. They don't want any more runs to score. 38 pops the third. And with two outs, it'll be Larry Brown. 49, single 1-10, and he gets an 8 and a single. And that will break Campisi. And they'll bring in Vince Colbert to try and get the final out against Tony Horton. Here's a who. The pitch to Tony Horton with the bases loaded and two outs. 2-6, rolls to third base. Do they have any defense to bring in? Well, they could take Horton out and put John Lowenstein in left field. There you go. Walton goes to DH. You could put Fred Stanley at short for Eddie Leone. He's a little bit better. And there you are. That is all the defense they can do here in a two-run game in the ninth inning. It'll be Bill Robinson, Jeter, and Kleins. It's almost like murderer's row for this. My goodness, we saw Bill Robinson's car earlier, so here he comes in the ninth inning. 1-3, flies to right. Now let's take a look at Johnny Jeter. Was a Padre in 1971. With this card, he hits 320 in 75 plate appearances. The pitch to Johnny Jeter, 47, is a K, and with two outs, all you gotta do is get 334 hitting Gene Kleins out. The pitch to Gene Kleins, 1-8. Well, that's going to be triple one double. That's a double. So the tying run with two outs is Daryl Thomas, who doesn't have power against lefties. As you saw his card, it's not very good. The only other player on the bench is Roberto Pena, and he's not much good either. So he'll pitch to Daryl Thomas with a chance to get a victory for the Tribe. The pitch to Daryl Thomas. 1-6 is a strikeout, and the Indians breathe a collective sigh of relief. They got a win in the series. Still have a lot of work to do, but have temporarily stopped the bleeding, and now they're back into the playoff hunt again. Mingori, a nice four-out save, a hit and a couple strikeouts. A strikeout for Mr. Romo as well. Two hits and a K. Actually, a hit and a K for Hilgendorf. Hargan does get the win. Four hits and four runs. The long ball did him in, but he still got the win. Let's see here. Colbert came on in the eighth. Got an out. Hitting in two-thirds for Mr. Campisi. two hits, an unearned run, three walks, and a K. But Rudy May takes the loss, and he didn't pitch very well. He gave up runs in three of his six innings. 10 hits, 5 runs. Four were earned. He walked one and struck out two. 1019, 0108, 612, 46, 3543, 4335. That is game number four. If you're wondering about coming back from 0-3, well, it was just done recently, as the Marlins did it against the Braves. It happens more than you would think in Strat-O-Matic than, of course, obviously, in traditional Major League Baseball. Because, let's face it, I play so many best-of-seven series every year in the regular season schedule, in the postseason tournament, and in the playoffs. So it's bound to happen. So it's not really that big a deal to come all the way back. Obviously, you do need to play great baseball for it to happen, though, right? The Indians now are 13-10. Sorry about that. Move this back over here. They're back to 13-10, the Indians, hitting .277 with a .407 team ERA. Mingori has 5 saves in 11 2/3 innings. That's nice. Not a lot of power to this point. Danny Walton has 5 homers, 14 RBIs to pace the team. I guess your leading hitter would have to be Frank Robinson with his 32 hits? Yeah. So Frank is your leading Indian hitter at .327. So the trade was very important, getting him from Baltimore in the offseason. Baltimore let him go to the Indians under this pact because they are no longer roommates in the American League East. Cleveland's in another division entirely with the Detroit Tigers. And the Orioles were hoping that Frank would help the Indians topple the Tigers because the Tigers have had the Orioles' number the last few years. That's the thinking in letting him go. Ohio players, hey, they're 11-11. That's great news for a fictional team. 274, 335 ERA. Wow, those are great numbers for this era. Really are. Doc Ellis is 5-0. 5-0, folks. With a 1.58 ERA. I smell an all-star appearance for Doc Ellis. Actually, it's a 70 card we're using, not the 71. Wait a minute, actually. Let me just double check this. No, but we are using the 71 Doc Ellis card. Well, that explains a lot, right? Because he started the 1971 All-Star Game, and wouldn't that be cool if he does the same thing in this go-around? Oh, I think it would be pretty awesome. The All-Star Game is in Cincinnati this year, because we're doing the 1970 All-Star Game scenario, which was in Cincinnati. 71 was in Detroit. But we got the Doc Ellis 71 card, and shoot, he might start the All-Star Game. Home runs, Bill Robinson, 10 home runs for the year, pacing the Ohio team far and away. He's also 32 for 85. That's a .376 batting average. Ohio could have several All-Stars go to the big game. Year to date now, we've played 338 games. Hitting .262 with a .387 ERA. We'll post the results of the rest of the series if necessary. Thanks for checking this out. We'll see you next time. Well, folks, an intriguing series beyond anything else. This is the box score of a game you just saw. 6-4 victory for the Indians. They're still down 3-1 in the series. Game 5 will also be in Cleveland. Let's take a look at that. Game number 5. It is a Indian victory behind Gaylord Perry. So good for him. I told you I was having troubles with him, but he finally got a win. He beats Don Wilson, who's struggling this year. Ray Fosse, two-run homer. A two-run homer by Duke Sims. Solo homer by Chris Chambliss. 8-5 win for the Indians. Not on our field. They have to go back to Ohio. Can the Indians come all the way back from 0-3 and win this series? Well, Game six, it was entertaining. Here's your game six. First inning, a two-base error off of Duke Sims, RBI single. Ohio's got a 1-0 lead. Then in the fourth inning, Frank Robinson, two-run homer. And that is your scoring until the ninth inning when they bring in Vicente Romo with Mingori loosening up. We get a single, a ground out, and a tying run at second. Or actually, yeah, the tying run at second. And Ike Brown's a right-handed batter, so Romo pitches to him. And Ike Brown blasts a game-ending two-run homer off of his own card. Would have been a homer against a lefty or righty. Didn't matter. Indians could not quite pull the comeback. The results of the series is that the Ohio players do win it, indeed, 4-2. The Indians, well, they're still 13-10. Those two wins helped a whole lot, avoiding the embarrassment. And the Ohio players are at 500. And that's where we are in the American League North. Thanks for checking this out. We'll see you next time.